Hi, Judy, in Milwaukee, Oregon. I live many, many years in the Portland area, so I love that area. How are you, Judy?
All right. It's lots of snow right now.
Oh, no
but
kidding.
First
Get
of all,
out of
praise
here.
God for your ministry.
Are you serious about the snow, huh? Oh, my.
To my husband 5 hours to pick me up from my children's school today. Anyway,
oh, wow. That's kind of unusual. Enjoy it. Be safe.
The Holy Eucharist is such a main part of our Catholic belief.
Yes.
Why isn't it mentioned in the Nicene Creed where it lists the things we believe? I heard somebody
yes.
explain it that when it was written, you know, most people believed in the Holy Eucharist, but nowadays
yes.
that's not always the case.
That is exactly right. It's a very good question. If you notice, of course, the creed begins, we believe in God, the Father Almighty, right? One Lord Jesus Christ, and then the Holy Spirit. So it begins with the fundamentals, the essentials of what we believe about God. And then you have the incarnation and the Catholic Church, you know, and so forth. If you notice, if you go down that list there, every aspect of the creed deals with matters that were serious controversies within the first 400 years of the Christian era. There was, if you go to the sects, for example, who were splitting off, creating heresies and splitting off from the Catholic Church, for example, the Arians in the 4th century, that of course the Council of Nicaea was called about. What did they deny? The divinity of Jesus Christ and the Trinity. That was their error, and so that's what they're responding to. The Council of Constantinople, you had the Macedonian heresy that denied the divinity of the Holy Spirit. And even beyond that, we have Monophysites, Monothelites, and such who are denying. Now, they would come a little bit later, but you had that in seed form as well, people denying various aspects of who Christ is. Most especially, you had those in the first and second century who are denying Christ for full humanity, hence you have the incarnation. You had those who are denying his full divinity, hence you have the emphasis on Christ, on Christ's divinity. You also had the Sabellians in the third century who were confused about Christ's nature. So all of those things are what are emphasized. But the key, and I think you mentioned this, is that among virtually all of these heretical sects, they believed in the Eucharist. There wasn't a denial. Now, granted, some of the early Gnostics and such that denied the divinity of Christ, though they had a kind of Eucharist, they certainly didn't believe in any real presence because they didn't believe Jesus had a physical body. But even they, you know, we get hints from, for example, St. Ignatius of Antioch, who's writing in 107 AD, and I think it's in his letter to the Smyrnians, where he talks about these heretical Gnostic sects and such that were falling away. And he says, and I quote, "They abstain from the Eucharist and from prayer because they deny that the Eucharist is the flesh of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ," right? So their denial of the Eucharist was focused on a denial of an essential Christological truth. And so the emphasis was on the Christological truth. And later, I found this fascinating years ago when I studied it, St. Irenaeus will talk about these same sects who were carrying on with their own liturgies. And one of the arguments Irenaeus makes, he says, "You guys, you Gnostics, you're not making any sense because you're claiming to celebrate the Eucharist and you're using the words, 'This is my body,' but you don't even believe Jesus had a body. So how can you be receiving the Eucharist if you don't even believe Jesus had a body? You contradict yourself." So again, the focus was on these heresies concerning the nature of Christ, the Trinity, the incarnation, was he fully God, fully man, and that sort of thing, and that's exactly what you see in the creed. But very importantly, of course, when you get down to the end of the creed, you know, we believe in the Holy Spirit, proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified and all that, or adored and glorified. Remember, it says he's spoken through the prophets, and we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. So we acknowledge that there is a church to which we must bow so that in the future, when more heresies arise, of course, this was not, contrary to some folks belief, the creed was never intended to be a one-stop shop for our Catholic faith. But, you know, it highlights those crucial beliefs that were the center of controversy in the first 400 or 500 years of the Christian era. But, of course, it provides for the fact that we have this one Holy Catholic Church that down through the centuries we must submit to when more controversies come to the fore. At any rate, does that help at all?
That does. Thank you very much.
All right, and thank you for your call.